Hey guys, good evening. Can you all see me and hear me? So welcome to the next class of this series that we are having on INICET Special Integrated Revision of Various Systems. So we did RUMAT yesterday, and today we have neurology, which is lined up, and tomorrow we'll be going into the abdomen with GIT and hepatobiliary systems. Just tell me if you can see me and hear me well, and then I shall start. Let me just refresh page. No audio, no video. Was that in the past and now you can see me? All right, great. So thank you. So thank you for that confirmation, and we begin with a few words on an academy. As you know, there are a lot of free classes and plus classes on the app that you can check out and you must check out if you are a PG aspirant. That is something that you must do. You can combine it with Iconic subscription and get PrepLadder also. So those of you who are junior students, you should make use of the offers which are going on the combined subscription at the moment, where the prices have been slashed. And Unacademy has also introduced the four-year subscription, and also the raise a hand feature has come up now, so you can check that out, where you can talk with the educator on the Plus platform and ask them your doubts in person. And these are the various batch courses which have all started, and these are the subscription offers. Apart from that, also this Sunday there's a scholarship test on pathology which is planned, wherein you can get free plus subscription. Alright, all of the details will be there in the link in the description, so definitely check that out. I mean, your exams have been delayed for quite some time, and I'm sure you guys are all pretty well prepared, so a good chance to get yourself a free plus subscription this Sunday. Alright, so do register for that, and you can use my code, which is ZVORA or ZVORA Live, in order for any subscription. So shall we begin? Again, this is going to be very quick. A lot of topics to be covered, a lot of areas that we want to look at, just so that you are exam ready. So let's start. So the first thing we want to discuss is something very, very important, which is stroke. So remember, stroke in general, we divide it into ischemic stroke, hemorrhagic stroke. These are the broad outlines. But an ischemic stroke is obviously the most common type that you will see. Hemorrhagic, 20% of the overall stroke. In ischemia, you need to know two types of further classification. It can be either because of embolism, which is usually from the heart, or it could be because of thrombosis. Most of the time, which vessel is affected in both, whether it's embolism or it's thrombosis, which is the vessel which gets affected? It is MCA in both cases, alright? So it's middle cerebral artery, again, which constitutes your large vessel stroke. When we talk about small vessel stroke, remember, again, it's the lenticulostriate branches. It's the lenticulostriate branches of MCA which get affected in small vessel ischemic stroke. The pathophysiology here, remember one word, which is lipohyalinosis. So lipohyalinosis or microatheroma formation, tiny atheromas basically, which form in these vessels, which leads to a lacunar stroke. Alright, so remember, that is the small vessel stroke, lacunar stroke, which affects the basal ganglia. Alright, so that is something that you need to know about the general classification. On the other hand, we have hemorrhage. So hemorrhage in the elderly, again, it affects the same area that your lacunar stroke affects, which is the ganglio-capsular location, means basal ganglia, internal capsule location, dense hemiplegia, that is the typical buzzword, right? So elderly, again, what happens? When there is hemorrhage, remember, these same lenticulostriate branches are going to undergo what? They are going to undergo formation of these very tiny little microaneurysms. Like you had microatheroma in the ischemic side of things, here you are going to have microaneurysms, which are called your Charcot-Bouchard microaneurysms, right? So CB or Charcot-Bouchard microaneurysms will tend to rupture and cause hypertension most commonly in the putamen, right? So this is the most common location of hypertensive hemorrhage, which is in the putamen. Apart from that, when we talk about hemorrhage in the young, I want you to remember two causes. One is rupture of AVM. AVM stands for arteriovenous malformation, where there's an abnormal communication between artery and vein through a cluster of vessels, which is called nidus, right? So these are dysplastic vessels, which are called nidus, which will rupture with increased pressure, and that will lead to hemorrhage. On the other hand, one more cause is drugs. Alright, so drugs which are sympathomimetic, like cocaine, again can lead to sudden acute onset hemorrhage, which you can see in elderly. Remember, in contrast to elderly, in the young population, you are going to see predominantly cortical or lobar hemorrhage. Whereas here, subcortical bleed is more common. Alright, so this was a general outline about stroke. Going on to the approach. So when you get a patient with non-reversible focal neurological deficit, and I ask you what is the initial investigation of choice or initial investigation that you will do, what is your answer going to be? The answer, remember, the first thing that you want to do is non-contrast CT. Remember, this is our best investigation. Why? To rule out hemorrhage. I want to rule out this 20% category who have a different management altogether, that this ischemic stroke is going to be thrombolyzed if it is in the window period. So here, initial investigation, NCCT. A lot of times we can pick up ischemic signs, alright, we can pick up ischemic signs, although there are no, that is not the purpose of doing NCCT, purpose is to pick up hemorrhage, but we can pick up ischemic signs such as this sign here. In the MCA territory, you would find hyperdensity. So this is the hyperdense MCA sign or MCA dot sign, right? So this is the hyperdense MCA sign, which indicates thrombosis. It indicates thrombosis of the MCA here. Apart from that, what else can we see? We can see that here in the MCA territory, you can find edema. You can find this hypodensity, wedge-shaped hypodensity, which indicates edema, which indicates evolution of an infarct that can blur the basal ganglia. So this sign is referred to as blurred basal ganglia. So various signs have been described, insular ribbon also, where an insular cortex would be edematous. Alright, so this is about the signs on stroke. Next question, when I ask you what is the most sensitive investigation to pick up ischemia, what is the investigation of choice now to pick up ischemia? I don't want to rule out hemorrhage, I want to pick up ischemia. What is the most sensitive investigation? Yes, answer is going to be diffusion weighted imaging. Alright, answer is going to be diffusion weighted imaging with ADC map. So just diffusion, remember, that will pick up ischemia as early as 30 minutes, right? So it's something which is the most sensitive to pick up the ischemic stroke. When I ask you what is the investigation to pick up penumbra, if that is a specific question, what is a penumbra? Penumbra is that salvageable zone around this infarcted area, which is completely gone, which is dead tissue. I have one salvageable area which can be salvaged, which can be revived if you reperfuse. If you basically open up the vessel, it can be again salvaged. So how do I pick that up? The answer for that is going to be this image. Anytime you see something in the world of black and white, something colorful, that is your perfusion imaging, right? So this is a CT perfusion imaging that you are seeing here, which can pick up penumbra as a mismatch. Remember, we will see a mismatch between cerebral blood flow and cerebral blood volume. Alright, so these are the various investigations we have partially for detection of stroke. Going ahead to various important images, what is this that I am showing you? Our discussion is already done on the theory. What are we seeing here? Something white on an NCCT, remember, acute hemorrhage in the setting of focal neurological deficit. Use other color than blue. Alright, fine. So what are we having here? This is white acute hemorrhage in the location of the putamen, right? In the location of the left putamen. So this is hypertensive hemorrhage. This is hypertensive hemorrhage, most common site, putamen in elderly. What about this? When I tell you a 25-year-old comes with this sort of a lobar bleed, and I ask you, what will your next step be? Again, acute cortical bleed. What do you want to do in a 24-year-old young patient? Next step is my question to you. You want to rule out AVM? So answer is, how do you rule out AVM? Tell me, what is the investigation of choice to pick up AVM, AV malformation? You want to do an angiogram? You want to do a CT angiography. So CT angiography will show you these cluster of vessels, the hallmark of AVM, which is the nidus, which is the abnormal communication, those dysplastic vessels joining the artery and the vein. Now, how do you want to treat it? What is the gold standard? If I ask you, what is the gold standard investigation? For that, answer is going to be DSA, wherein you can see that we have taken a run of the ICA through the MCA. You can see there is this cluster of vessels which is communicating here with the straight sinus. So, abnormal communication in the arterial run, we are seeing the filling up of the dural venous sinus, means that there is something abnormal, something communicating both of them. So this is the nidus, and what can you do? You can treat it. You can put a glue. Alright, so glue is an embolizing agent. You can put glue here. You can put in a coil also in certain cases and block the communication. Alright, so remember, it is diagnostic plus therapeutic, and that is why it is the gold standard. Alright, apart from that, there is a scoring system. Can somebody tell me the scoring system of AV malformation. What is the scoring system that we use for prognosticating AV malformations? It is called the Spetzler-Martin Index. So that's a Spetzler-Martin Index which takes into account three factors. In case they ask you as an all-except question, it takes into account three factors. One is the size of the AV malformation. Second, they take into account whether there's deep veins which are communicating or not. Like in this case, you have the dural venous sinuses. So if you have your deep veins and the sinuses basically which are communicating, there's a poor prognostic factor. And eloquent cortex. The cortex which is gone, did it have an eloquent function? Did it have a specific function? Again, poor prognosis. So these are three factors of Spetzler-Martin Index of AVM. Alright, so this was all about AVM and hemorrhage. Going ahead with the next sign here, a non-contrast CT showing a triangle, a hyperdensity in the venous sinus. So just like we had thrombosis of MCA appearing hyperdense, now we have thrombosis of superior sagittal sinus. So this is superior sagittal sinus thrombosis, and this is referred to, remember when I show you an NCCT, this is the cord sign. Isko delta nahi bolte, isko bolte cord sign. When I do a CCT, and I see that it is a filling defect. Contrast is not going in the superior sagittal sinus. Usko bolte hain empty delta. Theek hai? So, ye dono signs hai for superior sagittal sinus thrombosis venous infarct. Alright, going ahead. What was your doubt, Akshay? Can you just type it again? I seem to have missed it. Apart from that, what is this image showing? What is this image showing here? Again, hypodensity. So, it indicates ischemia in the subcortical region. Alright, which is showing you a small vessel stroke or a lacunar stroke. Alright, so this is how lacunar stroke is gonna appear. Okay, going ahead to the next set of images, the next condition. What is this? Empty cella. Empty cella is the presence of CSF in the cella. Alright, instead of the pituitary, we'll have CSF basically. So, pituitary gets compressed, that is empty cella, and that is seen with pseudotumor cerebri or in any case of raised intracranial. Alright, so that is what is empty cella. Coming back to this, yeah, so you are seeing in a non-contrast CT, what about that, Akshay? ICV thrombosis with bilateral thalamic involvement. So yeah, that will be seen when you have deep venous thrombosis. So that's a question, that's a comment. Alright, so whenever you have deep vein thrombosis, which is internal cerebral vein, vein of Galen, which is thrombosis, bilateral thalamus will get hyper intense. I'll show you one image and then we can discuss the DBs. Alright, okay, coming back here to this image. So this is hyperdensity in the basal cisterns, which, as all of you were saying, star of death, worst headache of my life. This is subarachnoid hemorrhage. This is subarachnoid hemorrhage that we are seeing here. On the other hand, when I show you such an image, that there is hyperdensity here along the anterior cisterns, that you are seeing this hyperdensity along the anterior part of the basal cistern only, along the lamina terminalis cistern. What is this? What does this indicate? This is called a sentinel sign. Alright, so this is called a sentinel sign, which actually tells you ki shayad yahi artery ka aneurysm must have ruptured, because this hyperdensity is in the course of that artery. So in this case, what can I say? Aage kaun sa artery ja raha hai? ACA. So can I say that either ACA or ACOM, which is the most common site at the junction, must have ruptured in this case. If I see hyperdensity alone in the sylvian cistern, can I say that most likely MCA must have ruptured? If I see ki pura star of death is involved, complete basal cistern is involved, I know that somewhere around the circle of Willis at the ICA posterior junction, there has to be a rupture. Alright, so that is how basically you can delineate, you can guess that this is the kind of hemorrhage which has happened. So, one-liners on SH. If I ask you what is the initial investigation, how are we going to detect, what are you going to do when the patient comes to you with worst headache of the life, you're going to be doing a non-contrast CT and picking up the hemorrhage. Once you see this, once you are suspecting that this is aneurysmal bleed, alright, it is along the artery, what do you want to do next to confirm? So, investigation of choice is going to be again a CT angio, just like AVM, just like AV malformation, same course you are taking here, where you would do CT angio to know. And in this case, what do you find? Same case here, we did the CT angio. Do you see here anteriorly in the junction of ACA? Look at the normal ACA. It should have been this small, and look at this aneurysmal growth. So this is an aneurysm in the course of ACA-ACOM junction. And when I ask you what is the gold standard investigation, again, it's just like AVM. All vascular pathologies in the brain, remember this. NCCT से start करेंगे, CT angio, gold standard DSA for all vascular pathologies. So here also, DSA is the gold standard and what does it show? Again, it shows you this aneurysm. Two options we have to treat. If you've done a DSA, endovascular coiling is what you can do, alright? So you have two kinds of options. What is being shown in this particular image? You've taken your catheter inside the neck of the aneurysm. See this, you've taken your catheter and you've deployed your coil. So this is how a coil would appear and you would place it inside the aneurysm. So endovascular treatment, coiling. Anterior circulation aneurysm rupture is rare, posterior rupture is more. That is true. So remember, anything in life which is more common is always good. Okay, so good. It's a good thing to remember common things. So anterior circulation, ACOM, AC is the most common site, but it's the least common site for rupture. It has the best prognosis. On the other hand, the posterior territory, the posterior aneurysms, basilar tip aneurysms tend to rupture the most. Coming back, what is this? So this is the clipping that the surgeons will do, alright? Now if I ask you if there's a wide neck aneurysm. Aneurysm hai jiska bahut wide neck hai, means if this is the vessel, it is opening like this. Which one will you prefer? Coiling or clipping? So remember the general principle when we are doing, we have a wide neck aneurysm. Clipping would be preferred because the coil deployment becomes very difficult, alright? So there are very high chances that the coil would come out and would undergo basically other complications, will flow away into the distal circulation, alright? So clipping is preferred, remember one indication when you have a wide neck aneurysm. Something else that can be done, a few, two advances I want you to know. So if you have wide neck aneurysm, do you see this? Iska kitna wide neck hai? Is there anything I can do endovascularly? Yeah, so I have two options in those cases. One is called stent assisted coiling. Do you all recognize the stent assisted coiling? Assisted ka spelling is wrong, just live with it. So stent assisted coiling, wherein we have put a stent first such that our coil doesn't go anywhere, alright? We don't want our coil to run away. So we've put in a stent here and then I put in the coil, alright, such that it is secure. So first process, stent assisted coiling. The other method, which is still not very routinely available in our country, which is called a flow diverter. Remember, flow diverter basically works by some physics principle wherein it predominantly, as the name suggests, diverts the flow away from the aneurysm. So it regulates the flow in this direction. So dheere dheere, because this guy will not receive any blood, it will undergo thrombosis, right? It will undergo thrombosis. So this is a flow diverter. Remember, one very important indication for this is giant aneurysm. Can somebody tell me what is the definition of a giant aneurysm? It is an aneurysm which is more than 2.5 centimeters. Just a correlation. What is giant aneurysm in coronary artery? When we say Kawasaki ka complication is giant aneurysm or aneurysm of coronary artery, what is that definition? Good. That definition is 8 millimeters. Just remember, saath mein 8 and 25. Alright, so this is 25 mm, this is, that was 8 mm. Alright, so this is about flow diverter, which can be used in wide neck and giant aneurysms. Alright, so this is a recent advance that you need to know. Apart from that, something very, very important about SH that I want to discuss, complications. First complication is re-bleed. So it can again rupture. So how do you prevent this? You basically treat. So remember, anybody who comes to you with aneurysm. Yeah, these are both recent advances for clipping. These are not treatment of choice. So far, just remember Shubham and Siddharth, both of you, that clipping and coiling are our standard treatments. These are recent advances wherein endovascular treatment can also be done for wide neck. Alright, but in practice, wide neck, clipping is the treatment of choice, but these have also been tried as recent advances, got it? Yeah, so a lot of you are saying nimodipine. Is nimodipine for prevention of re-bleed? Not really. Remember, prevention, basically re-bleed is, how do you prevent re-bleed is to treat every case of aneurysm. That is the moral of the story, that any patient who comes with aneurysm, you have to treat it with either clipping or coiling or whatever recent advance you want to do. That is how you prevent. If you leave the patient will re-bleed. Maximum risk is in the first 7 days. Apart from that, hydrocephalus is the second complication. How do you treat this? How do you treat hydrocephalus? So hydrocephalus, basically the first line would be EVD, which is external ventricular drain or a ventriculostomy that is done. If this fails, a VP shunt can be put. So remember, first line is EVD. It looks something like this. Alright, so an image based question can come where we put it in the lateral ventricle, the neurosurgeon will put it. This is how an EVD external ventricular drain appears. If this fails, then be patient. All right. Going on to the next one, the most important one, which is delayed cerebral ischemia, more famously called as vasospasm. So remember, vasospasm, again, highest risk kab hota hai sabse pehle? Maximum risk of vasospasm is between 4 to 14 days, peaks at 7 days. This is vasospasm. The most important thing, how do you prevent it? So this is prevented by the drug, which is nimodipine. Alright, so nimodipine is the drug of choice. You give 60 mg 4 hourly, alright, for 20 days. So this is nimodipine, which is the drug of choice to prevent. Remember, this is given prophylactically in order to prevent vasospasm. What about triple H therapy? Have you guys heard the triple H therapy, which was hypervolemia, hemodilution and hypertension? So we basically are giving a lot of fluid in order to prevent the vasospasm, right? So is this still done? Is this still done in practice? Answer is no, right? So this is no longer advocated, wherein now they say hypervolemia is out, hemodilution is out. The only thing which is now supported is just hypertension. So euvolemia is what is preferred now, and hemodilution bhi nahi karna. Hematocrit should be targeted at more than 30%. Alright, so this is the criteria now, where only hypertension is preferred, and this is according to this trial which they can ask you, which is important, which is the Himalaya trial. Alright, so you can remember apna Himalaya. So this is Himalaya trial, although the spelling is different. Okay, apart from that, and this process is called hemodynamic augmentation. So if they now ask you what is the standard of care, very, very important, it is called hemodynamic augmentation, which is permissive hypertension. Alright, everybody on the same page so far? Good to continue for some more time. So this was about SH. Just one-liner. What is this syndrome called when you have intraocular hemorrhage plus SH? Yeah, by syndrome.
What is this? Intraocular permissive hypertension. No, not hypotension. Permissive hypertension. Okay. This is called as Thurston syndrome. This is called as Thurston syndrome. Alright, so this is also something that can be tested. Going ahead with the next question. So for a thing, just to wake you up, what is this that I am telling you here? Voice issue? Abhi tak to what happened suddenly? My job.
Is it better now? Disturbed voice. Achanak se kya ho gaya? Something dropped. Nothing dropped from my end. Is it better now? Mic drop. This is all intervention from universe. When the... Now okay. What happened? No, there was no mic to begin with. Let me switch off the AC and now see if it... Can you hear just me, or are there other people also talking? Is it just me? No, nothing failed, guys. Huh? Theek hai, abhi better hai, chalo. So tell me, ab question batao. 19-year-old male presents to the ED complaining of acute neck pain and dizziness while at his usual chiropractic appointment. Chiropractic means it's a neck fix kar dete. When you have neck pain and you go to those local massage people, hai na? Matlab, it's not even local massage, like chiropractic is a profession in US, but India mein utna nahi hota. Okay, but like any sort of, that is the buzzword. Yeah, when either the patient is doing some yoga or some heavy neck augmentation, which is leading to sudden neck movements, violent neck movements, and you see this kind of a DSA. So this was the common carotid artery to begin with. Just follow the common carotid artery. Yahan tak theek tha. This is the external carotid artery anteriorly. What happened to ICA posteriorly? Do you see how it suddenly tapered? So this is called the string sign. Alright, so this is referred to as the string sign. Very, very important. This is the buzzword. The moment you look at it, where is it? That is chiropractic practice. This is suggestive of dissection. Alright, so this is internal carotid artery dissection. So when I show you a flashcard of these two images, first is the string sign of ICA dissection. What is this? Can somebody tell me what is the other hallmark of ICA dissection? Thurston syndrome. Ayush, Thurston syndrome. What is this? Yeah, so this is Horner. So the moment you see Horner syndrome, which is acute Horner's clinically with neck pain. This clinical buzzword can mean nothing but ICA dissection, alright? So remember this for your exam. This is how you solve clinical vignettes, alright? By focusing on the buzzwords that the examiner is giving you. Okay, I hope my voice is better and you are able to hear all of these things because they are very, very important. Okay, so this is string sign ICA dissection. Moving ahead to dementia, alright? Talking about dementia very, very quickly. What is this? Yeah, so because of the sympathetic chain around the ICA, you will have murders. Okay, yeah, so tell me about this. The first dementia, the first flashcard. Early insidious short-term memory loss is what the patient is coming to you. Later on, so first started with temporal lobe, right? Memory, temporal lobe. Later going on to frontal lobe, language deficits, spatial disorientation. Later, personality changes. So frontal, pehle temporal, phir frontal. So yes, this is Alzheimer's disease. Tell me three pathological things you will see in Alzheimer's disease very, very quickly. What are the three things? First thing you will see, neurofibrillary tangles. So NFT is what you will see. What are these made up of? So remember F and T. So F is basically, they will present as flame cells and they are composed of tau. Alright, so they are tau proteins basically which are accumulated. What about the neuritic plaques? So the neuritic plaques are going to be the alpha beta clusters, alright? So these are going to be the amyloid protein which gets accumulated. And finally, yes, what are Hirano bodies? Hirano bodies are accumulation of what? They are accumulation of actin. Okay, fatafat se treatment. Tell me the drug of choice. Tell me the drug of choice of mild Alzheimer's. When you have mild Alzheimer's, what is going to be the drug of choice? You are going to give acetylcholine esterase inhibitors, donepezil is going to be the first line drug. And when you have moderate to severe disease, the first line drug is going to be memantine, right? It's going to be memantine, which is anti-NMDA agent. Going ahead to the next one, the most common type of dementia in practice, stepwise decline. But if ek function is going, early motor loss, executive dysfunction ho raha. Imaging is characteristic where you are seeing infarction and deep white matter. So this is the most common type of dementia, which is vascular dementia. Remember the lacuna stroke? So when you have small vessel strokes, multiple small vessel strokes, eventually it will lead to this. Well, yes, the typical step ladder, stepwise decline. Next thing, early personality means now the frontal lobe is getting affected first. Very, very important buzzword. Apathy mil raha hai. Alright, so you are seeing apathy is there, disinhibition and compulsive behavior. So when you get dementia with compulsive behavior, this is the hallmark that we are talking about, FTD. Frontotemporal dementia, also called as Pick's disease, which wherein you see Pick bodies. Alright, so what are Pick bodies? Accumulation of, they are again tau protein with ubiquitin. Alright, so they are again tau with ubiquitin, Pick's disease. Going on to the next one. Parkinson ka modification. So when you see spontaneous Parkinsonism with visual hallucinations, buzzword, plus REM sleep behavior disorder, very, very important terminology. This is Lewy body dementia. What are Lewy bodies? Accumulation of Lewy bodies matlab, what are the accumulation of alpha synuclein, right? So there'll be alpha synuclein accumulation in Lewy body dementia. Next, very, very important, Hakim's triad. When you see Hakim's triad, which is wet, wacky, wobbly. Wet matlab urinary incontinence. Wacky matlab dementia. Wobbly matlab ataxia. So when you have frontal ataxia, when you have Bruun's ataxia, isko Bruun's ataxia bhi bolte hain. Okay, wherein you have magnetic gait. Remember, they'll have magnetic sort of gait. And what about the arm swing? Will the arm swing be preserved? Yes, very, very important. The arm swing gets preserved here in contrast to Parkinson's. Parkinson's will also have this fascinating sort of freezing sort of gait. So basically the way to distinguish both of them is on the basis of the gait, apraxia and the arm swing. Alright, so this, as you have all guessed, is normal pressure hydrocephalus. What will you find in normal pressure hydrocephalus? Imaging will show you lateral ventricles. Basically all the ventricles are dilated out of proportion to the cerebral atrophy. So you will see diffuse dilatation of the ventricles. That is what you will see. And what is the Miller-Fisher test? One of you mentioned Miller-Fisher test. So what will we see? The moment you do a CSF tap, the patient will improve. Right, so if Miller-Fisher test is positive, patient shows improvement, then the treatment of choice becomes VP shunt, right? So then you can treat the patient with three patients. What is this that I'm showing you? Image-based question aa sakta hai ispe. What is this image showing? This is a CSF flow study, alright? So remember, this is a CSF flow study which can be tested, which basically we do for patients of normal pressure hydrocephalus, alright? So this is about NPH. Going on to the last case, what is this? This is behavioral changes, very, very rapidly progressing with myoclonus, very, very typical prion disease, right? So prion disease, CJD, a few things to know. What is this sign called on imaging where the cortex shows this diffusion restriction? This is cortical ribboning. This is called as cortical ribboning, which is a sign of which type of CJD? Classical sporadic CJD or variant CJD? So this is a sign of sporadic CJD. On the other hand, when you see this, so Akshay, the image you were asking for, where you will see bilateral thalamic hyperintensity in cases of ICV thrombosis, so this is what it will look like, alright? So wherein the thalamus is hyperintense, so the same appearance will be seen at least with three disorders. One is variant CJD, where I call it the pulvinar or the hockey stick sign. The second one that you mentioned is any deep venous thrombosis such as ICV thrombosis. And what is the arterial variant which will also cause this? Artery of Perchron. So artery of Perchron infarct will also cause this appearance. Was this what you were asking? You asked this in one special class also. So this is what is variant CJD. What about the histopathological feature which will explain the name? Spongiform encephalopathy. So this is spongiform changes, the empty cells that you are seeing, that is the spongiform encephalopathy. And what is the EEG gonna show? EEG is gonna show periodic complexes, right? So periodic sharp wave complexes are what you are gonna see. Okay, so this is about, yes, Japanese encephalitis also, although it is not just the dorsomedial nucleus in JE, it's the complete thalamus. All of these will typically involve the dorsomedial thalamus. So like JE also, I have an image, I'll show you. Apart from that, what CSF shock protein we can do? We can do CSF 1344, although that, 1433, which is not very, very specific, alright? So that is, remember, it is quite sensitive, done in practice, but it is not very, very sensitive. Alright, so it's a heat shock protein that you can see here. Okay, so this was about prion disease. Very, very quickly, this baby stuff for you guys at least who have been attending the classes regularly. Head trauma, fatafatsa, because a short question comes, so I didn't want to leave out this also. So tell me, what is this on the right side? Idli shaped, does not cross the sutures, can cross the midline. Acute EDH. Remember, always remember to comment on acute, subacute, chronic. When it's white, it is acute. On the other hand, on the left side, banana shape, crescent shape, this is your SDH, acute subdural hemorrhage, which can cross the sutures, but it will stop at the midline, right? So it can cross the sutures, but it will cross at the midline. What are you seeing here? When the hemorrhage, when the acute hemorrhage is within the ventricles, this is acute intraventricular hemorrhage. Again, very, very important image-based questions. History of trauma, you find these heterogeneous, large, white areas most commonly involving frontotemporal location. These are cerebral contusions. These are cerebral contusions that you are seeing, hemorrhagic cerebral contusions. Please, a lot of you confuse this with concussion. Don't do that. This is contusion, concussion, CT will be normal. Alright. What about this? When you see nothing, patient is doing very bad neurologically, but you see that tiny petechial hemorrhages are there, or CT is completely normal. Diffuse axonal injury. Shearing of axons, histopathologically, what are you going to see? Histopathologically, you will see something called as retraction balls. You will see something called as retraction balls. Adam's staging is done. Investigation of choice, MRI, gradient imaging, susceptibility weighted imaging to pick up hemorrhage. Alright, so this is about diffuse axonal injury. Apart from that, anytime you have head trauma, intracranial pressure will get raised. There can be herniation as a complication. Four types of herniations you need to know. First is subfalcine. Subfalcine herniation, you'll have the cingulate gyrus crossing over. Tell me the complication. Which vessel infarct can result because of this? You can have ACA infarct, right? You can have ACA infarct, or you can have internal cerebral vein getting compressed. So this is first, subfalcine cingulate gyrus. Second, transtentorial, can be descending, can be ascending. Descending is far more commoner, which results when the uncus herniates. what happens here? Which artery gets compressed? PCA. Which nerve gets compressed? Third cranial nerve. And what is the unique false localizing sign that we see? Kernohan's notch. So what happens in Kernohan's notch? The contralateral side, anytime you have the uncus and you have the midbrain, the contralateral midbrain will strike against the tentorium, will get compressed, leading to ipsilateral hemiplegia. So the fact that you see ipsilateral hemiplegia here, that is called Kernohan's notch, which is the false localizing sign. Apart from that, tonsillar herniation is the worst type of prognosis. The moment your tonsil goes down, you will have respiratory depression, and imaging usually won't be done at this case. Okay, transcranial herniation is when you have any sort of defect, whether there's a fracture or there's a craniotomy defect or a Burwell defect and the brain comes out through that. That is again a very rare type, which is transcranial herniation. Alright, so these are the types of herniations and the complications. Going ahead, what am I showing you here? When you have so much edema, which is seen here, where the entire cerebrum is completely effaced, it's completely black, such that the cerebellum starts to appear white. Aisa bolne lag gaya ki cerebellum white hai. But it's not a white cerebellum, actually it's the black cerebrum that we are seeing. So white cerebellum sign is seen with complete diffuse brain edema. So when you have extensive brain edema, that is what is seen in white cerebellum sign. Treatment for all kinds of raised intracranial pressure is going to be what? So it's going to be a common flowchart that you do, whether it's traumatic or non-traumatic raised intracranial pressure, wherein the first line that you can do as a bedside procedure is what? Elevate the head end. Alright, so that is the first thing that you can do. Apart from that, you have to put in a ventriculostomy tube. And what are the osmotic agents that you can give? Alright, so mannitol, first line drug. What are the conditions where you can give steroids? So remember, steroids are indicated only in two things: when you have either an abscess or you have tumor. Remember, steroids are absolutely contraindicated in cases of any ischemia, any hemorrhage, any trauma. Alright, so you're not gonna give steroids. Mannitol is gonna be your first line drug. If it doesn't respond to all of this, then you have to go for mechanical ventilation, you go for other second line therapy. Alright, so that is in a nutshell what you do when you have a patient of raised intracranial pressure. Going ahead, so do you want to continue? There's a lot that I have for you. I'm going super fast. In yesterday's video also it was quite fast, but I'm just doing it for you so that you can get a quick revision. If you feel that nahi thoda aram aram se padhna hai, then just let me know. All right because yesterday also somebody commented that, ma'am, you did not take any pause in between. So I'm also not breathing, just for you guys, that you can do well in your exams. Okay, so all right going ahead. So when you have a patient who's an alcoholic, what are the two things that you are saying? When you are saying hyper intensity, periaqueductal gray and mammillary bodies. So again, when you have the dorsomedial nucleus, when you have the dorsomedial thalamic nucleus, that same area getting involved as prion disease, you have periaqueductal gray and you have mammillary bodies, you think of what? Very good. You think of Wernicke's encephalopathy, you think of GOA. What is GOA? Global confusion of thalmoplegia, ataxia, right? So that is what you will see. Eventually you will have Korsakoff, psychosis, confabulations. What about this? The moment you see chronic alcohol and the pattern is showing you corpus callosum involvement, the disease, that the big disease that you think of is Marchia Fava Bignami. Very good. So this is Marchia Fava Bignami disease that you will see in chronic alcoholics when there is demyelination of the corpus callosum fibers that you are seeing in black areas, deep center. So that is the demyelination. Okay, so this is about alcoholics. What is this? Very, very important. Like, this is something that I expect in your INICT exam, like, to be very honest. Okay, when you see posterior white matter edema, very good. This is PRESS. This is posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. The buzzword here, please look out for preeclampsia. Please look out for a patient who is on chemotherapy or any patient who is having hypertension. So, what kind of white matter does it affect? Posterior white matter. Is it reversible? Yes. So, if I ask you, is there going to be diffusion restriction here? Is there going to be diffusion restriction? No. There's no cytotoxic edema. This edema is vasogenic edema. Cytotoxic edema shows diffusion restriction, vasogenic edema doesn't. Alright, so it's just the vasogenic edema of the posterior white matter fibers. Alright, so this is PRESS. Please remember this, guys. Very, very important. Going ahead, when I show you this cluster of images, a young female comes to you saying कि कभी मुझे sensory loss होता है, कभी मुझे एक आँख में दिखता नहीं है, कभी मुझे motor symptoms होते हैं, when I take a hot bath, my symptoms worsen, I have an electric shock-like sensation going down my spine, what does she have? She has multiple sclerosis. When you have this dissemination in time and space, different symptoms over different time, the criteria is McDonald criteria. Alright, so remember multiple sclerosis, Lermit's sign, Newtox phenomenon, which I described in my description. I'm sure you guys picked it up. What is this? This is a flare image where I suppress the CSF to see that there are these periventricular demyelinating plaques. There are these periventricular demyelinating plaques which are referred to as Dawson fingers. These are Dawson fingers. What is this? This is a contrast enhanced MR that is showing that this is the normal optic nerve not enhancing. This is optic neuritis. So remember, asymmetrical optic neuritis is the hallmark. Okay, so this is multiple sclerosis. Thank you for asking me to breathe. This is multiple sclerosis. Going ahead to the next one, by the time you guys answer this, this is something that all of you have to answer. Wonderful. So what are we seeing here? We are seeing that there is central hyperintensity in the pons. So this is osmotic demyelination syndrome, previously called CPM. For more information, read Ritvik's comment. Okay, so this is osmotic demyelination syndrome, wherein the central pons will get demyelinated, again will occur because of rapid correction of hyponatremia. Going ahead to the next thing, two signs have been described, the trident sign and the piglet sign. All right. Those are the two signs which have been described. 5 more minutes. You guys are up for continuing. Fatafat se infections dekh lete hain. So, when you have any patient with headache, vomiting, fever, and 3 buzzwords, your diagnosis will depend on it. Do you hear that? When you have stiff neck and photophobia, what do you consider? God, this is meningitis. This is meningitis. Piglet means apna Winnie the Pooh wala piglet, alright, so any pig ka baby, that is piglet. So this is meningitis. Altered mental status, what does that buzzword tell you? So remember, whenever you have altered mental status, A, vowels stick together, think of encephalitis, right? Encephalitis. Then we have focal neurological deficit. Whenever you have focal neurological deficit, you think of abscess, alright? So these are your buzzwords for a clinical diagnosis. Going ahead, what are these that I'm showing you? Alright, so when I tell you this person has altered mental status, a young boy coming with behavioral abnormalities, a very, very important buzzword. You did a CSF tap, you found RBCs, you found xanthochromia. So what is the hemorrhagic most common encephalitis? Very, very important, HSV. So remember, herpes simplex virus, this is the predominant area where it affects the temporal lobe. It will affect the cingulate gyrus, temporal lobe areas of the limbic system, resulting in behavioral abnormalities. Apart from that, also remember one more thing, one DD of this. Whenever you see temporal lobe encephalitis, again, one more unrelated DD, autoimmune encephalitis. Alright, so autoimmune encephalitis is the differential for HSV. Yes, when I tell you focal neurological deficit, the buzzword tells you abscess, very thick rim enhancement. This is abscess, right? Going ahead to the next image. So, anytime now that we talk about meningitis and I ask you what is the investigation of choice for meningitis, what is your answer going to be? Your answer is going to be a CSF analysis, a CSF tap. But when would you want to do imaging before CSF? So, imaging before CSF, these are the indications. Fails P. So remember, these are not indications of LP contraindicated. These are indications where you want to do imaging first, rule out intracranial pressure which is raised, and then go to it. Okay, I'm sorry Miss Medicine that I am so fast, but you can always see this again, alright? So this is just fast so that it gives you more high yield information in lesser amount of time. But that's the only purpose, otherwise I can do this slowly also with a lot of pleasure from my side also. Okay, so just so that you can revise more quickly, that's the only purpose. Okay, so fail speed. So what are the things where you want to do imaging? So first, F stands for focal neurological deficit. Again, because you are suspecting an abscess, you want to do imaging first. It's not going to be useful to do a CSF tap. That's why. A, altered mental status. I, when the patient is immunocompromised, again you are suspecting some sort of intracranial lesion like toxo, like lymphoma that you want to rule out. L, what is L that you are going to see? When you already know ki isko to brain tumor hai, isko to lesion hai, you can't just proceed with CSF tap immediately. S, when the person has seizures, again you want to rule out some sort of pathology inside. And P is going to be papilledema, obvious sign of raised intracranial pressure. So when you see the signs fail speed, you want to do imaging before doing the CSF tap. Next, what are these images showing? So when you see this thick enhancement, imaging, yes, you can do NCCT upfront just to rule out whether there is raised intracranial pressure or not. Shubham, after that you proceed with your definitive investigation, which is contrast enhanced MR. Remember, any tumor, any infection, investigation of choice, contrast enhanced MRI. Alright? So, this is our basal exudates of TB. So, TB meningitis, what is the triad? TBM. One is basal exudates. Second, hydrocephalus. So, basal exudates, hydrocephalus. And because your circle of Willis is floating here, what's going to happen to the vessel? Vessel is going to be inflamed, there's going to be vasculitis. Apart from that, you can have these conglomerated, ek dusre ko chipakte hue ring enhancing lesions. That is called as tuberculomas. Tuberculomas. What is I in FALSP? I in FALSP is immunocompromised. Immunocompromised patient wherein they will have focal lesions that we'll see. What about all four of these images which have these four stages, vesicular, wherein you'll only see a cyst with a scolex. When you have edema around the lesion, when you have granular nodular, you have a lesion with calcification. And nodular calcified, dead scolex, only calcification, starry sky appearance. This is neurocysticercosis, and these are the four stages which are Escobar stages. And this is a question which is going to be a filtering question in your exam, which is always going to be asked. Two questions which is always coming in your exam, no matter which paper you are writing. One is neurocysticercosis, second is pneumoperitoneum. If you get these two wrong, rank ko bhul jana. Okay, so rank ko mat bhulna, images ko yaad rakhna. Alright, so this is neurocysticercosis wherein you are having these cystic lesions with central scolex. Alright, so any of these four images you see, you have to think of neurocysticercosis. Going ahead, when you have immunocompromised patient, why were you doing imaging first? Why were you doing imaging first? We are doing imaging first to look at all of these lesions which are expected. Bilateral basal ganglia, soap bubble appearance. These are cryptococcoma. So this is cryptococcus. When you see bilateral basal ganglia, target lesions, ring enhancing lesion, T for target, T for toxoplasmosis. When I see a focal, solid, solitary enhancing lesion, this is primary CNS lymphoma. Two rarer infections, and finally, Akshay, what is this? When you see bilateral thalamic involvement, bilateral thalamic hyperintensity, this is Japanese encephalitis. Very, very important expected question. Alright, so the inflammation, the infection that will cause bilateral thalamic hyperintensity, JE. One extra edge point, which infection does JE have a odd association with, which nobody really knows why. Ki in dono ka kafi common association hai. It is JE and NCC. Remember, it is intricately related to neurocysticercosis, especially in our country. Alright, and nobody really knows ki dono ka kya nata hai. Okay, so remember, this can be tested in AIMS. And what is the first image showing? First image is showing bilateral cerebellar hyperintensity. So can you tell me which infection, viral infection in a child, multiple stages ke pleomorphic skin lesions, a lot of you must have had it in your childhood, just the complication hota hai, ataxia, cerebellitis, it is varicella zoster virus, very good. So VZV ka complication hota hai, cerebellitis, and that is why these babies can have ataxia. Alright, okay, so I had aphasia also planned. Do you want to do aphasia or can you just see the crack need series on aphasia? It will take 5 minutes. Do you want to do a fair quick revision in 5 minutes? Chalo kari lete ab chhodenge nahi. So we have three. Whoever wants to go can go. So we have three areas, which are the Broca's area, Wernicke's area, and the arcuate bundle joining them. Okay, so Broca's area, where is it located? Inferior frontal gyrus. What is the Brodmann area of Broca's area? It's going to be 44-45. What about Wernicke's? Yeah, it is 22, superior temporal gyrus. Now the beauty, which vessel affects them? Inferior frontal gyrus, remember, superior division of MCM. Superior temporal gyrus, inferior division of MCM. Remember this. So this is the vascular supply. Now, anytime you have any lesion here, anytime you have a lesion of Broca's area, what will you have? Broca, broken speech. Anytime you have Wernicke's aphasia, Wernicke's area getting affected, you will have what? Comprehension will be lost. Banda bolta jayega, but samajh nahi aa raha hoga ki kya ho raha hai. Right? So, Wernicke's aphasia. Apart from that, when you have conduction aphasia, what will happen? Dono intact rahenge, but repetition is lost. Remember, repetition being lost is a hallmark of this. If you have Broca's, repetition will be lost. If you have conduction, repetition will be lost. If you have Wernicke's, repetition is lost. What if you have a lesion encompassing everything? That is called as global aphasia. So in four kinds of aphasia, repetition will be lost. If repetition is intact, what does it mean? It means that there is transcortical aphasia. Remember, the other type, transcortical aphasia, is something wherein the repetition is going to be intact. Okay, going ahead. What if I show you this cartoon and I ask you ki ye kaisa aphasia hai? Banda ko soch raha hai ki mujhe apple chahiye, but he is saying I app. So what is this? This is going to be what? This is going to be broken speech, right? So this is broken speech. So this is Broca's aphasia. This is Broca's aphasia. What about this? When the person is speaking all sorts of gibberish, person is saying all sort of jargon, apna apna neologism bana ke he is saying, but it doesn't make sense. So he is speaking very fast, but it's not making sense. Comprehension is not there. So this is Wernicke's aphasia. On the other hand, banda speaks very fine. Sab kuch theek se bolta hai, but you ask him, please repeat the word apple. Then the banda is like, what? So when the repetition is lost, but everything is fine, then what is this? So this is the isolated conduction aphasia. Did you guys understand? So this is how you delineate the three types of aphasia. Alright, so let's draw this table from U world and everything should be good. So how are we gonna, approach this? So this is the line which indicates that the repetition is lost. Poor repetition. So can I say, ye apne teen bundle mein se kuch na kuch gaya hai? Wernicke, Broca or the conduction, right? So this area above is one of these two, one of these four. So when I ask you that fluent speech nahi hai, but good comprehension, what is it gonna be? Non-fluent speech, broken speech. So this is gonna be Broca's aphasia. When I ask you, comprehension is poor but speech is fluent, what should I write here? Wernicke's aphasia, right? When I say comprehension be good hai, speech be fluent hai, but repetition is poor, what is it gonna be? It's gonna be the conduction arcuate fascicle, which is gone. So this is conduction aphasia. On the other hand, when we go to the next side, here where the repetition is good. So now what does this mean? It means that there is transcortical, right? There is transcortical aphasia. So when I say transcortical with broken speech, can I say it is transcortical frontal or transcortical Broca's aphasia? Yes. When I say there's poor comprehension, when I say this is transcortical Wernicke's aphasia? Yeah, so this is transcortical motor or transcortical, transcortical sensory aphasia, right? On the other hand, when I say here that non-fluent speech bhi hai, poor comprehension bhi hai and repetition is good, what is this? What is this called? Iska naam kaun batayega? This is called as isolation aphasia. Alright, this is called as isolation aphasia, where you have no comprehension, you have no speech. So isolation means what is the only thing this person can do? The only thing this person can do basically is good repetition. Alright, so when you can only repeat, that is isolation aphasia. Alright, so this is about the aphasia table. If this was fine for you, that means aphasia is sorted. Alright, so yeah, this banda will go on repeating, which is echolalia. All right, so this was all that I had for you. I hope this was useful. A lot of things which we covered in the last, 50 odd minutes. So thank you so much. Tomorrow I'll be meeting you with GIT and hepatobiliary, hopefully a smaller class than this. Today got stretched on a bit more. I became a bit greedy about what all I wanted to include. So I hope this was useful, and I'll post the annotated PDF on the group as always. Thank you so much. No class on the app tonight. I'll see you all tomorrow. Okay guys, so bye and good night, and study well.